Headline Audio presents Vanishing Act by Bill Kitson, read by Mike Rogers. Prologue, November 1965. As the set drew to a close, the group began to play the opening chords of their latest hit, still at number one in the charts after 5 weeks. Although it was cold and foggy outside, the auditorium was packed, sweaty, and deafening. The sound of the group on stage, relayed by huge banks of speakers, was soon surpassed by the shouts, cheers, and most of all, the piercing screams from the audience. Most of the crowd that had flocked to see the group were teenage girls, desperate to get close to their idols. Behind the group, depicted in garish neon, their name, Northern Lights. It was 1965, the heyday of rock. 4 encores later, still deafened by the shrieking adulation of their fans, the band made their way off stage. They headed down the warren of Newcastle City Hall's corridors to their dressing room. A phalanx of security guards surrounded them and ushered them inside. 2 remained standing like sentinels outside the door. One of the roadies greeted the triumphant musicians and told them they had to wait for the limo that would take them to the hotel following the final gig in a long and exhausting tour. After what seemed an age, the senior roadie appeared to summon them. "There's a right scrum outside the stage door," he warned them. "I reckon there's even more heat outside than there was in the theatre." He turned and gestured towards the auditorium, and as he did so, realised something was wrong. "Where's Gerry?" he asked. The band members looked around, as if expecting to see their lead singer lurking in some dark corner. Then they looked at one another in perplexed surprise. A babble of denials followed. "What you're saying is nobody's seen him since you left the stage, right? But he can't be waiting in the car, can he?"
"Probably found something he fancied and stopped off for a quickie," the drummer suggested, accompanying his comment with a lewd gesture.
"I doubt that."
The roadie motioned to the security men.
"Go check in and around the auditorium. I suppose it could be, like he says, and some tasty bit of jailbait has waylaid him. Don't disturb him if he's having a knee trembler, though. Where he's been behaving lately, you're liable to finish up with a black eye."
As they began their search, one of the group's most ardent fans walked nervously towards the river, glancing over her shoulder from time to time. Her instructions were clear, but as she waited by the riverbank, Julie Solanke was uneasy. The area was deserted, dimly lit. The large amount of money she was carrying made her feel highly vulnerable. She heard footsteps, but as the approaching figure appeared out of the gloom, Julie realized it wasn't the dealer she had been sent to meet. She saw the distinctive jacket and was about to greet him to congratulate him on the group's performance when he turned abruptly and headed towards the Tyne Bridge. Julie was surprised. He must have seen her, must have realized what she was doing there. After all, he'd been the one who'd passed her the message from the dealer. Before she could ponder this, a car drew up alongside her. Seconds later, the deal was done. As Julie set out to deliver the drugs, she caught a fleeting glimpse of 2 figures, their faces seemingly averted, also heading for the Tyne Bridge. They vanished into the shadows. It would be years before she had cause to remember them. It was over half an hour later before the men reported back.
"We checked on stage and around the ground floor. We also did the balcony and the foyer. We even checked every cubicle in the box, both men's and women's. God, they're in a ruddy awful state, some of them. We thought he might have slipped into one of them if he wanted to get his end away, but no luck. For us or him," he ended with a grin.
"I went down to the stage door, and when I could make myself heard above the wailing throng, I asked the others if they'd seen Crowther," his colleague added. "I thought he might have slipped out without anyone noticing him. But they said he definitely hadn't been through there." He grinned. "The fans would have eaten him alive if he'd ventured out that way."
"I can think of worse ways to go," the drummer commented.
"The thing is," the first security man told them, "nobody's seen him. There's no trace of Crowther in this building, and I can't see any way he could have got out of here. He's vanished. Utterly and completely vanished into thin air."
Chapter 1, December 1981.
I want you to find a dead man.
Those were the words Lou Patterson spoke the first time we met. It was a clear, cold winter's morning, the sunlight making the frost on the fields sparkle like thousands of tiny diamonds, and Eve and I were returning from our morning stroll. Since Eve had moved from London to join me at Dean Cottage in the Yorkshire Dales, it had become a ritual we both enjoyed and gave us the chance to discuss our plans for the day. On this day, as with many in the immediate past, these centred on our plans for the extension to the cottage. When we reached the brow of the hill that marked the boundary of Lathbrig Village, we were surprised to see a car parked in the lane in front of the gate. Not just any car, either. The gleaming paint and sleek, majestic lines of the bodywork proclaimed it to be no less than the ultimate in luxury, a Rolls-Royce. Wow, that's some piece of metal.
I wonder who it belongs to. Do you think it's someone visiting us? Eve asked.
If so, they must be friends of yours. Nobody I know could afford the wing mirror for a car that expensive.
As we approached, the driver stepped carefully out, obviously wary in case his expensive, highly polished leather shoes came into contact with anything untoward. I was still admiring the man's smart, tailored business suit, which seemed totally out of place in our surroundings, when Eve recognised our visitor.
It's Lou Patterson.
See, I knew it had to be one of your plutocratic friends. Who's he?
Alice's husband. You remember me telling you about Alice Patterson, the barrister? She and I were friends in London. She represented me at my appeal.
Long before we met, Eve had been found guilty of attempted murder after stabbing her violent partner with a carving knife. The conviction had been overturned on appeal when Eve's counsel had been able to produce evidence and eyewitnesses who testified to the man's long-term abuse, which had culminated with him scalding Eve with boiling water. It was in an attempt to escape this torture that Eve had retaliated.
Lou, this is a pleasant surprise, Eve greeted Patterson before introducing me. How's Alice? Is everything all right?
She's fine. She sends her best wishes. She wanted to come along, but she's in court all this week.
How did you know where to find us?
It would be hard not to. You two seem to be international celebrities. I read about your exploits when I was in Rome last week. Even there, the papers and the TV bulletins carried stories about you both. I had to come to Yorkshire on business, so I thought I could kill two birds with one stone, so to speak, because I have a favour to ask.
Why don't we go inside and have a cuppa? Then you can explain why you're here,
Eve suggested. A few minutes later, when we were seated in the lounge, Patterson explained. It was seen in a newspaper article that prompted the idea. I talked it over with Alice, and she reminded me of that other business you were involved in at some castle or other. It seems you two have a talent for detective work.
We don't go seeking it, Eve protested. It just seems to find us. Adam's an author, and nowadays I'm learning to be a housewife, editor, and critic. And before long, I plan to be a building site foreman, all rolled into one. We've had plans for an extension approved, she added, by way of explanation.
I understand, and I won't be offended if you refuse, but I do need some help, and you'd be ideal. For one thing, I know I can trust you, and you living here makes it even better.
Why not tell us what it is you want us to do? I suggested. Patterson paused and took a deep breath.
It's a long story, but basically, I want you to find a dead man.
As an explanation, Patterson's opening statement was more baffling than revealing. I blinked, and to cover my surprise, which I could see was mirrored by Eve, I said, There are lots to choose from. Graveyards round here are full of them. Patterson gave me a pained smile, so I continued, I assume you have someone specific in mind. First of all, I should explain my background. Eve knows a bit about me, I guess, but not too much. I'm in the music business. At least, that's my main sphere of operation, although I've diversified in recent years. I started out as a roadie in the 60s, and then became a manager for several groups and solo artists. It was a golden time for British pop music, and the whole thing blossomed from there. Currently, One of my brightest stars is a young girl with a great future. She's only 16, but she's already had a couple of hit singles. There are more songs waiting for her to record that I'm certain will make her a megastar. It's one of those songs that's the problem. The girl's name is Trudy Bell. You may have heard of her. I certainly had. And I could tell from Eve's expression that she had too. Last week, Patterson continued, we received a registered letter at my office addressed for her attention. Inside was some sheet music, plus a demo tape. That's by no means unusual. Fans often send in stuff, imagining they've written the next number one and asking their favourite pop star to record it. I had it down as just another of those losers, until I scanned the dots. Sorry, you've lost me. I could tell by Eve's expression that she didn't understand either. I meant when I'd read the sheet music, it looked really good. So I played the tape. As soon as I heard the melody, I knew the song would be just right for Trudy. Whoever composed it knew exactly how to tailor a ballad for someone with a voice like hers. That made me curious about the songwriter. I was convinced it had to be someone with a profound knowledge of music.
I take it you'd no clue as to the identity of the sender, Eve said.
No, there wasn't a letter or anything.
What about a return address on the envelope?
There was, but it wasn't much help. It simply said, John Smith, care of Barclays Bank, Harrogate.
So the composer wishes to remain anonymous. Where's the problem with that?
Patterson turned to me. Adam will understand, being an author. It's all to do with copyright. Unless we can get the writer's signature on a contract, we could lay ourselves and Trudy open to huge claims if the song does become successful. I get that, but I still don't see where the hunt for a dead man comes in, I said. I listened to that demo over and over. All the time, something was nagging at the back of my mind. You know how it is when you see someone in a street and recognise them but can't put a name to the face? Well, it was a bit like that. Or when you read something and feel sure you know the author, even if you can't remember their name. It's pretty much the same with musicians. If you hear something, you can often tell who it is playing or singing even before they announce it.
That's true, I agreed. I only need a few bars to recognise Miles Davis, for example.
That's exactly what I mean. I was still struggling with it when, quite by chance, I heard a record from 1964 on the radio. That was when I knew who the player was. I knew, without doubt, that not only had he played, but also that he'd composed the song on that tape. There was only one problem. It couldn't possibly have been the man I had in mind, because he died in 1965.
Maybe he recorded it before he died, and someone else sent it in, Eve suggested. His wife, perhaps? Or a close friend?
Patterson shook his head. He wasn't married, had no family, and precious few friends. Apart from that, back then it would have been reel-to-reel tape, not a cassette. Besides which, it was in stereo, not mono.
Okay, so who is this mysterious composer? I take it we're discounting it being the work of a ghostwriter.
Patterson groaned. It didn't say anything in that newspaper article about your weird sense of humour.
Eve snorted. If you think that's bad, wait until he really gets warmed up.
Patterson leaned forward and set his mug down carefully on the coaster. What do you know about Northern Lights? He must have anticipated my reply because he added swiftly, I'm talking about the pop group, not the Aurora Borealis. The name was familiar enough. I seemed to remember they were tipped for stardom. As I recall, some people reckoned they might be as big as the Beatles or the Rolling Stones. But then something went wrong and they were never heard of again. Wasn't there some sort of scandal? Patterson looked at me mockingly. I thought you used to be a reporter. Not in those days. Back then I hadn't reached such heady heights. I used to manage Northern Lights. You were right. They would have been huge if they'd stayed together. Looking back, I think it was inevitable that they would have split up sooner or later. What happened in 1965 just made it sooner.
What was their problem?
You name it, and you'd probably be right. Backbiting, jealousy, petty squabbles, professional rivalry, women, all fueled by booze and drugs. At the root of it all was the fact that the group had split into two factions. Everyone knew that but for the genius of one of their members, they'd still have been playing pubs and working men's clubs, earning a pittance and struggling to get gigs. It was like that before Gerry Crowther joined them. He had a good singing voice, and he was an exceptional keyboard player, but his genius lay in his talent as a songwriter. Crowther composed all their hit singles, plus every track on their LPs. He was both talented and prolific, and most of the others hated him on both counts. Patterson paused and took a sip of his tea, which must have been cold by then. Crowther actually chose the most famous lineup. He knew he could mould them into a unit capable of producing the sound he wanted. In the process, he insisted they replace some members of the original lineup. Several of the others protested, but deep down, they knew they would have to go along with Crowther's ideas if they wanted to succeed. You'd think that would make them grateful, but in fact, it seemed to make them resent him even more.
"What happened to cause the split?" Eve asked.
Northern Lights were playing their final gig of the tour in Newcastle in November 65. At the end of their set, the group went back to their dressing room to unwind and waited for their transport. After a while, someone noticed that Crowther wasn't there. When they couldn't find him, everyone went into panic mode. Eventually, the truth came out. It seemed Crowther had walked from the venue to the Tyne Bridge and jumped to his death. He was seen near the bridge by one of the group's fans. It was a long time afterwards that his body was recovered from the river. There was no possibility of a mistake. They even recovered his trademark leather jacket.
Was it very distinctive?
Unique around the northeast, I reckon. It had the name and image of Crowther's hero, Buddy Holly, on the back. I blinked with surprise. I've got one of those. I've had it for years. Mind you, I got mine in New York, not Newcastle. And you must have got it wrong. If Crowther died in 1965, someone else must have played on the song. I didn't get it wrong. I'm convinced I didn't. I'm sure it was Crowther who wrote and played that music. No one came close to his style. If you're right, whose was the body in the river? And how did they come by Crowther's jacket? Patterson shrugged helplessly. I've no idea. That's why I need your help. Accepting that you believe Crowther is alive, why ask us to find him? Isn't that the sort of job a private detective would be better at?
Or the police, perhaps, Eve added.
The police won't get involved. As far as they're concerned, Crowther's dead. Even if he didn't come to any harm and simply vanished of his own volition, they won't be interested. It isn't illegal to disappear. As for private investigators, I've very little confidence in their ability. There are other reasons for asking you as well.
Such as?
Back then, I got a firm of private detectives involved, and details of Gerry's disappearance appeared in the press within a couple of days. At that point, we were trying to keep it under wraps. The leak must have come either from my office or the inquiry agent. I'm still not sure which.
What are the other reasons?
Patterson spoke slowly, choosing his words with great care. There are aspects to this case that I wouldn't want to entrust to them. Like I said, there was a lot of strife within Northern Lights. Crowther only had two allies within the band. Neville Wade, the drummer, and Billy Quinn, the lead guitarist. After Gerry disappeared, Quinn's behaviour changed. He became introverted, morose, with hardly a word for anyone. Soon after Crowther's body was recovered from the river, Billy was killed in London. At the time, I thought he'd simply made a bad mistake. But now I'm not sure. So I thought that the best chance of finding Gerry without anyone getting wind of what's going on would be to involve a complete outsider and someone who had no previous connection either with me or Northern Lights.
So you picked us because you want to avoid anyone learning that Crowther's potentially alive. That's the only reason.
Not quite. For one thing, Crowther was born in this area. Well, West Yorkshire, to be exact.
I particularly remembered because the place name was so unusual that I had to ask him how to spell it. It was Myth Holmroyd.
I smiled and corrected Patterson's pronunciation. If everyone believed the suicide story, they must have thought Crowther had a reason. Do you know what that might have been? Patterson was silent for a moment before answering.
Musicians are an odd bunch. A few are normal, level-headed individuals. I'd have put Crowther in that bracket. But towards the end, he became more difficult, shall we say. About a month or two before he vanished, his behaviour changed abruptly. I got reports back that Crowther had started drinking. He certainly wasn't a teetotaler, none of them were, but I'd never seen him drink much.
And you've no idea what caused the change?
No. I thought his death was the culmination of his downward spiral and assumed that drink, drugs or depression or a combination of all three had finally got the better of him.
Patterson smiled, rather sadly.
The three Ds that are the bane of performers everywhere. Now I'm not sure what to think. If Crowther is still alive, then the mystery of why he vanished is greater than ever. Apart from that, he continued, I have a piece of evidence to show you.
What's that?
Eve asked. He produced a large, registered envelope from his briefcase.
This is the envelope that the music came in.
He pointed to the top right-hand corner.
When Alice saw that, she convinced me to drive up from London to visit you. She said it was too good an opportunity to miss.
The envelope bore the postmark of the village of Alaskar, no more than 15 miles away from where we were. Before Patterson left, we'd come to a compromise. Although we'd agreed to try and locate Gerry Crowther, as Eve pointed out, we couldn't consider starting to make inquiries for some months.
You've asked at a very bad moment, she told him. The builder starts work straight after New Year, and Adam is working to a deadline. We'll have to refuse if you need something doing in the immediate future.
That's not a problem, Patterson smiled. It isn't as if I need the music for Trudy to record next week. She has several more potential songs lined up, just not as good as that one. How does this sound? If you agree to take the case, I'll gather all the background material I can find together, and when you give me the go-ahead, I'll send it up to you via registered mail. You can start by having a look through it all and let me know if there's anything else you need. Then you'll be au fait with the facts. It'll take me quite a while to get all the info down on paper anyway.
As we watched him drive away, Eve said,
Lou's comment about taking the case makes us sound like real private detectives.
That's true, and I hope all the villagers saw Patterson's car outside our house. It'll do wonders for our reputation.
They'll probably charge us double for the work we want doing on the house.
I looked at my intended with interest. Are you certain you weren't born in Yorkshire?
Now that we've decided to play detective, have you an idea where to start?
There isn't much we can do until Patterson supplies that background material. I have had one idea, though.
Only one? Adam, you're losing your touch.
Eve has a great talent for insulting me. What's more worrying is that I'm starting to enjoy it. I think a trip to Mythomroyd sometime in the future might pay dividends.
Mythomroyd? Why there?
That was where Crowther was born. He might have returned there after the supposed suicide. Alternatively, we might find someone who could give us a clue as to where he is now and what he's been doing for the past 16 years.
Eve shook her head sadly.
Your thinking might be good, but your arithmetic is lousy. I counted 3 ideas, not one.
Okay, then. Here's another idea for you. Your friend Patterson was a little less truthful in a couple of respects.
I closed the door and followed Eve into the study.
In what way was he untruthful?
He said the police wouldn't be interested because no crime had been committed. That isn't really right. If Crowther didn't commit suicide that night, what did become of him? And if someone else's body was washed up later, wearing Crowther's clothing, might that not make police suspect that Crowther might have been responsible for the unknown's death?
You think Crowther might have vanished because he'd murdered someone and dressed the corpse in his jacket to make it appear as if it was him who had died?
It's a possibility. And I reckon that's the real reason Patterson doesn't want the police involved. The other reason might be connected to Quinn's death. Patterson merely said he was killed. He didn't elaborate.
which I found a bit suspicious.
Chapter 2.
Work on the extension went better than we could have hoped, helped by an unusually mild winter and spring. The end of May saw the new part of the building ready for occupation. Our home was no longer small. The extension had changed the cottage into a house. It was with great ceremony that the plaque bearing the name Eden House was installed, replacing the previous Dean Cottage. I held Eve close as we gazed at the sign. "Well, my little builder's foreman, you've certainly proved your organisational skills," I smiled at her. "Perhaps the next thing you can organise could be a wedding."
"That'll have to wait a bit longer. You've another book to finish first, and there's that job we promised to do for Lou. Besides, who mentioned marriage?" "I happen to like collecting jewellery," she said, staring at my mother's engagement ring on her left hand.
"If you're that keen on rings, then I'll buy you a gold one to go with it."
It was early July before I had time to spare. Eve then phoned Lou Patterson to ask if he still wanted us to try and find the missing musician. He seemed pleased that we were ready to make a start and would get the paperwork sent through as soon as possible. We had finished our evening meal when our phone rang. Eve answered it, and her greeting of "Hi, sis," told me it was her older sister, Harriet, who was calling, or Lady Rowe, to give her her correct title. Harriet was doing most of the talking, because all I heard from Eve were several monosyllables, followed by an "Oh dear, that's terrible. How is he?" She ended the call by saying, "I don't know. I'll tell Adam and see if he's got any bright ideas. It's unlikely, but you never know."
"Problem?" I asked as she put the phone down. I can be very perceptive at times.
"And how? You know they're all supposed to be jetting off to the States."
I nodded, and Eve continued.
"It looks as if the whole trip will have to be cancelled. Tony might have to go to that conference in New York on his own."
Eve's brother-in-law, Sir Anthony Rowe, was scheduled to attend an international business symposium in New York, and that had been the planned springboard for a 6-week holiday for the whole family, including Lady Charlotte, Tony's mother. "Why? What's gone wrong?"
"Charlie's been sent home from school after spending 2 days in the sanatorium. He's gone down with a severe case of tonsillitis. He's got a high temperature, and there's no way the doctor will allow him near an aeroplane until he's better. That means Harriet, the twins, and Lady Charlotte will all have to stay at home."
Charles Rowe, Tony and Harriet's son, now 15 years old, was a great favourite of ours. The solution seemed obvious. "Tell Harriet we'll go across to Mulgrave Castle tomorrow. Bring Charlie back here and take care of him. That way the rest of the family don't miss out."
"That's brilliant. But that would mean he has to stay here for over 6 weeks. Are you sure?"
I raised my eyebrows, shook my head and sighed. "I'm surprised you didn't think of it." Eve's response was an extremely rude gesture. She rang Harriet back, then told me.
"The rest of them are thrilled, and Harriet says even Charlie has cheered up a bit. He's been very down at the thought that he might be responsible for everyone missing such a huge treat."
Next day we arrived at Mulgrave Castle to find the Rowe family in the throes of last-minute packing. This was postponed as they greeted us. Then Eve and I went to collect our patient. Charlie had developed from an energetic, cheerful, slightly impudent child into an intelligent, athletic, and humorous teenager, with none of the behavioural problems normally associated with that age group. When we first met, I had been impressed by his ability to judge people. Since then, I'd realised that he was extremely mature for one so young. This, together with him being tall for his age, tended to make people treat him as an adult rather than a teenager. Although he had every right to be depressed at missing out on his holiday, he seemed to be taking the disappointment stoically. Or perhaps he was simply too poorly to care. One glance at his flushed face and the lackluster expression in his eyes told us he was far from his normal self, even before he attempted to speak. The result of that was a barely audible croak. With Eve talking to the patient, I bent to pick up the cases Harriet had finished packing. As I did so, I glanced at the poster on Charlie's bedroom wall. I blinked with surprise and straightened up.
I didn't know you were a fan, Charlie.
He nodded, which it seemed was easier than talking. Eve looked at the poster.
That's Trudy Bell, isn't it?
The young pop star was certainly a very attractive girl, and there was no doubt that Charlie was smitten.
What a strange coincidence, Eve told him. Adam and I were only talking about her yesterday. Her manager is a friend of ours. Perhaps we might be able to arrange for you to go to one of her concerts.
Having wished the Rowe clan a safe journey, and promised to take good care of the heir to the baronetcy, we returned to Eden House with our guest. It was indicative of how poorly he was that after ordering him to bed, Eve went up to give him a dose of the medicine prescribed by their doctor, only to find Charlie fast asleep.
What shall I do?
She asked me. Leave him be. Sleep and plenty of fluids will do him as much good as the medicine. Charlie's condition had improved only marginally a couple of days later, when we took delivery of a large and extremely heavy parcel. Bored with staring at the wallpaper in the spare bedroom, Charlie spent his waking hours watching cricket on TV in the lounge.
There seems little to choose between the two, Eve commented.
At least the TV picture keeps changing.
Charlie's reply was the first sign that he might be on the mend, even though it came out as somewhere between a growl and a squawk. As an antidote to boredom, I explained what the parcel contained. I think Patterson sent every file from their office, judging by the size and weight of it.
Can I help?
Charlie inquired. Eve looked as though she was about to veto the idea, but I thought it would do Charlie good, and bravely told her so. Why not let him, Evie? There's plenty of work there for three of us. As I explained later, Charlie has a keen and inquiring mind. Moreover, he loves mysteries. I could tell when he was listening to the story of Crowther's disappearance that he was intrigued. And when I mentioned Trudy Bell, he could barely contain his excitement. It will take his mind off his illness and prevent him moping.
Okay. I take your point, Adam. I just don't want him to make himself worse.
I don't see that sitting in the study reading files is that much different from sitting in the lounge staring at the telly. If Boycott's batting, it'll certainly be more exciting.
I'll take his temperature before I make my mind up. If that hasn't dropped, I'm not allowing it.
Although Charlie's temperature wasn't back to normal, it had reduced sufficiently to satisfy Eve.
Okay, Charlie, you're in. But the minute you begin to feel tired, you stop. Got it?
Yes, Aunt Evie. He muttered.
He waited until her back was turned and then winked at me, mouthing the word fusspot at the same time. I turned away so that Eve couldn't see my grin. Having unpacked the parcel, we surveyed the young mountain of paperwork it had contained. Where the heck do we start with this lot? I wondered.
I thought we could begin by looking through the ones about the band lineup, as it was when Crowther vanished, plus the others who were there that night, Eve said.
That sounds logical, but what do you mean by the others?
The tour manager, the roadies, hangers-on, fans, groupies even, and pressmen.
It would help if Patterson had supplied an index. I don't suppose you've come across one, have you? I looked up to see Eve brandishing a sheet of paper. Oh, good. Let's get cracking, then. We spent the rest of the day going through the files. By the time we gave up, we had barely got halfway through the stack. But by then, we all agreed that our brains couldn't absorb any further information. We resumed the following morning. I think we should each take a third of those folders and read the contents. Then if we find anything interesting, we can bring it to the attention of the others. The file I found most interesting in the stack I went through was the one referring to a former band member, one of those ousted by Crowther's insistence on a change of style. His name was Wayne Barnett. I read some of the details out before passing the file to Eve.
It doesn't sound as if Barnett went quietly, she said.
What does Mr. Patterson say about him?
Charlie asked. Apparently, Barnett tried to sue the group collectively and the members individually, plus Patterson's management company, claiming breach of contract. The actions failed, but Barnett wasn't prepared to let the matter rest at that. His resentment and bitterness boiled over into violence following a Northern Lights appearance in Stoke-on-Trent in the latter part of 1964. he took a sledgehammer to the group's boss and broke the jaw of one of the roadies who tried to stop him. He then got past the security guards and burst into the dressing room. Before the guards pulled him away, he had Crowther pinned up against the wall and was trying to throttle him. Crowther escaped with nothing worse than a black eye and a sore throat. Eve paused.
Now this is interesting. Apparently, Crowther refused to press charges for the assault and paid off the roadie who was injured. He also shelled out for the repairs to the bus. Why do that, I wonder?
Probably because he felt guilty that Barnett had lost what he must have seen as a golden opportunity for stardom. Nevertheless, it's intriguing. I bet Barnett didn't appreciate the gesture, though.
Why do you say that?
Human nature, I suppose. If you hurt someone and they forgive you, it can make you hate them even more. Eve and Charlie went on to relate what Patterson had written about some of the other group members, both those that had left and those still playing when Crowther disappeared.
There's not much info about a couple of them, Charlie said. There's a note saying both these blokes were sacked, as well as someone called Tony Kendall. But there's nothing in the file on him apart from an address in Newcastle and a phone number. There's even less information about Carl Long. All it says is whereabouts unknown, which isn't much use. All the stuff about Long and Kendall dates back to the 60s. I'm surprised it isn't written in Latin, it's that old.
Don't be so cheeky, Eve told him. Adam swears that a lot of people had started using English by then.
Oi, you two, show some respect for your elders and betters, I told them. The one Lou seems to know most about is Robbie Roberts. Apparently he's become very rich and successful. He started a magazine, then went into property. His portfolio is handled by a property management company because Roberts is no longer a UK resident. Lou says he's a tax exile. Charlie looked up.
What's one of those?
I'm not sure of the precise details, Eve told him. But I think anyone who isn't resident in this country for more than 90 days a year doesn't have to pay tax here. Those who want to keep hold of their ill-gotten gains move to tax havens, which means they only pay a very low rate of tax there.
It all sounds very dodgy, Charlie commented, with the blunt innocence of youth.
Extremely dodgy, I agreed. But it's not something that's ever worried me, not on the sort of money I was paid.
Eventually, I suggested we call a halt.
I think we ought to visit the former band members. We've got little or nothing from the files. Perhaps talking to the guys who knew Crowther before he vanished will pay dividends.
So where do we start? They're not all exactly accessible. One of them lives in Australia. I can't see Lou Patterson funding a trip down under simply to spend 10 minutes talking to an aging rock guitarist.
Okay, so we stick to the ones within striking distance.
And what excuse do we give for talking to them? We can't say we're looking for a man who's been dead for nigh on 17 years, can we?
That's a good point, Evie. We'll have to think about that. There was a prolonged silence. This is quite unusual in our house, except perhaps on Armistice Day. Eventually Eve broke it.
I've got an idea.
Charlie and I listened.
We could tell them you're an author. They can check that out easily enough. That establishes your credentials, especially if we throw in the bit about being a former TV correspondent. We could explain that you've been commissioned to write a series of articles about 60s pop groups, either the ones who didn't make it or the successful ones that split up. We could tell them it's intended to be a sort of, where are they now?
That might work, but the first question they would probably ask is, who commissioned the series?
We could say it was Lou Patterson.
If we tell them that, the first thing they'd do is check.
Then we forewarn him. Simple, really.
Charlie and I stared at her admiringly.
That's brilliant, Aunt Evie. You've thought of everything. Once we've done that, what do we do?
Two of the people from Northern Lights live in Leeds, and that's where the eyewitnesses used to live.
Who are the musicians who live there? I asked.
Pete Firth is one of them. He played guitar. He stayed in the music business, sort of. He works as a DJ at a disco close to Leeds city centre. The other is Jimmy Mitchell, Charlie told us after looking through the folders. He read aloud. Jimmy Mitchell, the bass guitarist, joined the army, but was dishonourably discharged for fighting with another squaddie. He was later convicted of assault following a pub brawl and went to prison. After his release, he returned to Leeds. He's currently working as a mechanic in a garage.
Sounds like a nice boy. I'm really looking forward to meeting him, I said.
Charlie grinned and turned to another file.
Not only that, but there's a groupie who saw Crowther after the gig. If we can locate her, she has to be worth talking to.
His enthusiasm was growing.
And if we're going to Leeds, Charlie concluded, what about the guy who used to be their drummer? He's a vet now, based in Harrogate. His name's Neville Wade.
We're probably better just turning up on the off chance, I suggested. A vet will often get called out on emergencies, so making an appointment would be difficult.
Hang on. What's all this we business? Eve inquired. What makes you think you'll be going with us, Charlie? And who'd speak to us with a teenager in the room?
Oh, come off it, Evie. You can't leave Charlie kicking his heels here. He's missing enough fun already. Besides, he might pick up on something we miss.
Yeah, Aunt Evie, you could say I'm on a work experience course.
Eve looked from me to her nephew and back.
And which of you is going to explain to my sister that we're taking her son into possible danger?
Whoa, who said anything about danger?
All we're going to be doing is talking to people in the most innocent circumstances. No way is there going to be the slightest bit of risk for any of us. One of these days, I'll learn to stop making such rash predictions.
Okay. Who's going to phone for the appointments?
Eve's question signalled her capitulation. Charlie grinned and gave me a thumbs-up sign, which, fortunately, his aunt didn't see. Once we'd set up our cover story with Lou Patterson, the squabble over who should call the musicians was settled by Charlie. Eve had maintained that I should do it, as the author. My idea was that she should pose as my secretary.
Why not take it in turns? Charlie asked.
He looked through the files again.
There are plenty to go at. Two of the former members of Northern Lights are in or around Newcastle, as well as the ones in Leeds. Steve Thompson, the other vocalist and saxophone player, now works as a bouncer in Newcastle. There's also the other guy, Tony Kendall.
Eve made the first call to Pete Firth. As she was talking to him, Charlie remarked,
"It's lucky Mr. Patterson has all their details."
"Why is that? Do you know?"
"I think it's to do with sending them royalty checks. Every time someone plays one of Northern Lights' records on the radio, the musicians on it will be entitled to a share of the royalties."
Eve ended her call and reported her success. Just how successful she'd been, we were not to discover until we arrived in Leeds. She handed me the receiver, and I tried to contact Jimmy Mitchell. I was nowhere near as lucky. After I put the phone down, Eve asked,
"How did it go?"
There was no reply. "Let's try the Newcastle ones instead. I'll start with the mysterious Tony Kendall." Like my previous attempt, my call was a short one, but this time the line had been discontinued.
"It may be disconnected," I suggested. "We could go to the address, just in case."
I handed the phone to Eve. "You try Thompson. You seem to have more luck than me."
Chapter 3.
Charlie appeared next morning, sporting a shirt and tie beneath his sweater and clutching a notebook and pen.
"Got to look the part," he informed us as we climbed into the car.
Eve shook her head and sighed. The journey to Newcastle proved to be a waste of time and fuel, or so I thought at the time. Steve Thompson, the former sax player turned bouncer, provided little fresh insight into Crowther's character, his disappearance, or the reason he committed suicide. I sensed a deeper feeling of anger and resentment in Thompson, directed at Crowther. The closest I got to a meaningful response was when I asked Thompson, "Don't you think it curious that Crowther committed suicide when the group was such a success?" Thompson's reply, although not in itself informative, was accompanied by an expression that I couldn't identify. Eventually, I realized it was one of guilt and shame, but for what reason, I had no idea. I decided on an outlandish way to try and find out the underlying emotion.
"If he did commit suicide, that is."
"You're not suggesting Gerry Crowther was murdered, surely? That's crazy. Why would anyone want to kill him?"
"Crazy, possibly, but why would he want to kill himself? He had everything to live for."
That idea's laughable. You should be locked up. Or is this going to be a work of fiction?
No, I merely put it forward as a possible alternative.
You're mad,
Thompson stammered, his eyes reflecting his anger.
Of course he bloody topped himself.
I wasn't sure, as he spoke, whether Thompson was trying to convince me or himself. Something in his eyes told me we'd outstayed our welcome. I thanked him, and we took our leave.
What did you make of him?
Eve asked, as we drove towards the address Patterson had given us for Tony Kendall, one of the guitarists who had lost his place in the original lineup. I wouldn't trust Thompson further than I could throw him. What's more, I'm convinced he's hiding something.
He didn't like it when we asked about Crowther. It made him very uncomfortable.
We reached the address and stared in dismay at a large expanse of overgrown, weed-filled grass.
What's happened? Charlie asked.
At a guess, I'd say this is slum clearance. It's a shame there hasn't been any redevelopment. One thing for certain, we're going to have to look elsewhere for Kendall.
Having failed to gather information in Newcastle, we hoped for better in Leeds. What we got was more than we bargained for. Eve insisted Charlie stayed home. The trip of the previous day had left him tired, and she was concerned that he was not as fit as we thought. The disco where Pete Firth worked was near the city centre. When we arrived, he was waiting in the foyer. Firth was 39 years old, but his appearance suggested someone older. The mane of black hair that had been a 60s trademark was tied into a ponytail which was liberally streaked with grey. The boyish good looks female fans found dangerously attractive were now etched with lines, suggesting that life had not been easy for the former guitarist. I wondered how much the ageing process had been accelerated by Firth's drug habit. Patterson's background notes gave an air of authenticity to my cover story. Although we knew the answers beforehand, Eve scribbled furiously on her pad. Whether she was transcribing Firth's answers or writing a shopping list, it certainly made us look the part. I asked Firth about Northern Lights, eventually broaching the subject of Gerry Crowther as a preamble to the key question surrounding his disappearance.
Crowther should have gone it alone.
Firth's voice was a deep growl.
He was more suited to a solo act than as part of a group. Don't get me wrong, he was a brilliant musician and songwriter, but he was a complete misfit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.